Great. Good afternoon and welcome. My name is Deborah Rosenblum, and I'm the Executive Vice President here at NTI. NTI is honored to be co-hosting this event today with Women of Color Advancing Peace, Security, and Conflict Transformation, Out in National Security, and Gender Champions in Nuclear Policy. George Floyd's tragic murder sparked national and even international dialogue on pervasive and structural inequities in our society. As we reflect on this injustice, it's important for us to ask ourselves, what can we do to bring down barriers of hate and discrimination, not only within society writ large, but also importantly, within our policy community and our own workspaces? This is why we're here today, and we're very much looking forward to engaging you in a lively discussion. We have a full agenda. We'll start with remarks from NTI's co-chair and CEO, Ernie Moniz. That will be followed by a distinguished panel featuring Ambassador Bonnie Jenkins, Jane Rhee, Loyce Pace, Shawn Skelly, and Ambassador Laura Holgate. After our panel discussion, we'll open us up for a virtual floor from questions from all of you. Before I turn it over to Secretary Moniz, let me highlight a few quick details about our webinar today. First, and importantly, we recognize that this discussion addresses issues that can't possibly be covered in a 90-minute segment. That's why we're planning to continue to host and participate in future webinars on topics related to diversity, inclusion, equity, and justice. We want your feedback on which topics are important to you. And in order to do so, we're going to be running a series of polls over the course of this webinar to get your feedback. None of your individual answers will be posted, but we will be aggregating them so you know what we're going to be doing in the future. During the seminar, we also encourage you to ask questions of our panelists. And to ask the questions, please use the Q&A button at the bottom of your screens. And finally, keep an eye on the chat. We'll have links to our speakers' biographies, reports, articles, and other publications that will pop up in the chat. We'll also be emailing you this information afterwards. I now am pleased to turn the floor over to my boss, NTI co-chair and CEO, Ernie Moniz. Ernie?
Thanks. Thanks, Deb, for that. And welcome and to all of you. And thank you for joining us on this in this webinar. And also, let me repeat Deb's statement that we at NTI are very pleased to sponsor this event with our partners, Out in National Security, Women of Color, Advancing Peace, Security, and Conflict Transformation, and Gender Champions in Nuclear Policy. Today's program is focused on diversity in two critical areas of practice for NTI, nuclear policy and health security. The professionals in these fields work every day around the world to address some of the greatest threats facing humanity. And the problems we face are difficult and they are urgent. If we aren't hearing from a diverse set of experiences and perspectives, we won't solve them. And yet we know significant challenges remain to ensure that all voices are heard and respected. The fact is, if we don't embrace these voices, we won't be able to come up with new ideas and innovations to address threats. And we do need new ideas in these areas. And again, without them, we won't achieve a safer world. And that requires addressing structural inequities. And again, respect for everyone is a fundamental pillar of a safer world. However, that work really starts at home. And to be truly successful, we must recognize also the how we do our work, recognizing its importance right up there with the work that we do. The field as a whole needs to prioritize diversity, equity, and inclusion as mission critical. Widening the aperture of inclusion allows us to challenge our assumptions and ourselves create richer conversations, more durable outcomes, and more creative approaches. We shouldn't leave, we can't leave talented, passionate people on these issues out of our conversation. Each of our panelists represents in their own way an action-oriented approach to promoting diversity, equity, and inclusion. Their work has produced important resources, programs, and initiatives. We can all learn from them, and we will learn from them, and I appreciate the time that they'll spend with us today. We stand alongside our partners in solidarity to support the values of diversity, equity, and inclusion, but we know we must also, again, take our own actions. NTI, like many organizations, has committed to a long-term process to actively improve our ability to deliver on these values. And today, I want to just share a few steps that we are taking, some new steps. First, we've just launched a formal task force on diversity, equity, and inclusion with representatives from each part of NTI. This group has been functioning informally for a few months, but we are enhancing its place in our institutional activities. Its mission is to develop, advance, and implement strategies and actions that support NTI's goal of embracing diversity, promoting a culture of inclusion at all organizational levels, as well as attracting and retaining top talent with diverse perspectives and experiences. Only through a strategic set of concrete goals and benchmarks for advancing diversity, equity, and inclusion will NTI be able to do its best work and deliver on its mission to reduce catastrophic risks. Second, we are committing to expand our internship program to ensure that we are drawing on the talent at HBCUs and other minority-serving institutions. One example I'm very fond of repeating is how in 2016, I accompanied then Vice President Biden to Norfolk State University, an HBCU, to dedicate a DOE NNSA program to meet urgent future needs, namely to train HBCU students in cybersecurity. And now it's time for NTI, with a relatively recent important focus on cybersecurity, to take advantage of those undergraduates and graduates of such a cybersecurity program. Third, we will increase organization-wide training to include topics such as understanding implicit bias, as well as empowering bystanders. We've also renewed our annual commitments to gender champions in nuclear physics, and nuclear policy, excuse me. We could use it in nuclear physics too, but in nuclear policy, we are very pleased to have been leaders in that initiative, along with our friends at Plowshares. We're now committing to expand part-time benefits to enable both women and men to better balance work and family, provide interns with sick leave, increase gender-relevant training, and continue with NTI's focus on diversifying its board, staff, events, and partners. So I encourage you all to engage with the organizations represented here today and others who operate in this space. If we take action to promote diversity, equity, and inclusion in our communities, we can change the status quo. So thank you again. I look forward to the outputs of today's conversations, and I'm pleased to turn things back over to Deb to moderate our distinguished panel. Thank you.
Thank you, Ernie, for those remarks, and also for challenging us to be open to think differently and for encouraging us to really listen to others on this collective journey. We now want to ask you a few questions with a quick poll. Thank you very much. We appreciate your answers. We'll be displaying them in a little bit. I now want to turn to our panel. Each of our guests have an impressive accomplishments. And to learn more about them, you can find their bios posted in the chat screen. To get our panel started, I've asked each of them to give us some opening remarks about themselves, to comment on why this topic is particularly important to them, and to share the kind of change they would like to see in the nuclear policy and health security fields. So with that, I'd like to first turn the floor over to Bonnie.
Thank you, Debbie. And also thank you, Secretary Moniz, and also all of you for joining us here today. I also want to thank NTI, of course, for inviting me. This is a great topic to talk about overall. It's something that I've been very much engaged in for most of my life. And the moment that we're seeing now where organizations and individuals are really focusing on the issue of diversity, equity, and inclusion is certainly something that's overdue, and we're so happy to see such an engagement by so many different organizations and individuals. This is an issue that, as I said, I've been involved in for a while. I've been in the field of nuclear weapons, international security, national security since the early 90s. And, you know, it's been very interesting being in the field with so few people of color. And when I started out, a few women, and I'm very happy to see there are so many more women and young girls who are interested in the field. But when I started out, of course, that was not the case. And we still find that there's quite a bit of a challenge in getting people of color in the field of international security and national security, and particularly in foreign policy issues. There's a number of reasons for that that range from getting people into the field early on in their careers, helping them understand why these issues are important early on in their careers, and recognizing that we need to do more to engage young people in these fields, also, you know, young, but also when they're going into college as well. And there's also, as you know, probably know, a lack of visibility for those who are in the field, the few who are in the field. There's also a lack of mentors in the field as well. So all of these are things that are causing there to be fewer people of color in the field right now. I'll leave the discussion about global health to Loyce. All I will say there is, in my work, I've seen that there's quite a few women in the field, quite a few women of color in the field of public health and working in the laboratories, but also there is a lack of women leadership in roles in that field as well. There are a number of things that we are doing. I started the organization in 2017, really for this issue, to try to figure out how we can increase the voices of women of color in these fields, to find out how we can develop a better pipeline to bring young girls and women into these fields, and also how do we keep them in these fields once they do decide to enter them. So for me, it's a problem of pipeline, and it's a problem of the culture and trying to change the culture and understand what are the barriers that are keeping our voices from being heard. And many of those reasons are the reasons that you've heard from Secretary Moniz as well, in terms of why our voices are needed, what's wrong when we don't have those voices, and how, when we're trying to address the kind of challenges we're trying to address today, that we need all the voices and all the intellect around the room to address these issues. And we certainly can't afford to not have different viewpoints and understandings about ways to address these issues. So for me, dealing with the problem means doing a number of things, developing a pipeline, as I said, providing role models, providing visibility, developing programs. My organization has a working group that's focused just on chemical, biological, nuclear, radiological issues, as well as on global health. We hold programs just to get our names out there, for people to see that there are women of color out there working on these fields, and to also let the young people see who is working on these fields as well. We also find ways to provide opportunities for them. We're doing a publication of women of color on issues of CBRN that's coming out in next month. And these are ways to increase the visibility. And finally, I will end with just saying that one of the things that the organization did recently, and we're very happy that NTI and Out National Security also signed on to a statement that we released on June 9th that now has over 200 signatures from organizations and practitioners in various fields of peace and security, national security, human rights, humanitarian issues, and all types of organizations, whether they're think tanks, NGOs, or philanthropy. And there are 12 commitments in that document. If you wanted to see it, you're welcome to go to our website to check it out. but we're very happy that so many organizations understood the need to make change. We welcome all of this. We welcome others who want to work with us on this. We're going to be doing, first thing is a questionnaire, which we're going to be sending out tomorrow to all of the organizations that sign on, because it's important to sustain this feeling and this effort and this momentum. We can't afford to let this end, because other issues come up. Other issues will always come up. But that's one of the reasons why things have never changed, because we keep moving on. We forget that this is a moment, and this is a moment that has to be a momentum that we continue. So thanks again, NTI, for inviting me to do this. I'm looking forward to all the questions that will come my way. So thanks again.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Bonnie. We look forward to talking with you later during the panel. We now are going to turn to Jane. I'd like to hear from you.
Hi, good afternoon. Thanks so much, Deborah, and everyone at NTI for hosting this discussion. I'm really privileged and honored to be on this panel with people I've actually talked a lot about diversity and inclusion issues in the past. So I think this will be a fantastic discussion. Just by way of introduction, I did not study nuclear issues when I was coming up in college and grad school. However, I was a Foreign Service officer. I came into this field from a political angle, actually. And throughout, you know, like a lot of people, I think, not surprisingly, I joined the Foreign Service shortly after 9/11, and it focused a lot on the Middle East for the majority of my career. And I had the opportunity at a certain point to really focus more on Iran. And of course, the biggest issue there being the nuclear program. I worked on that issue both at the State Department and at the National Security Council, and was able to meet a lot of great people, a lot of whom are actually now at NTI, and were enormously helpful in helping me actually feel like this was a field I could get more involved in and learn more about, and not feel intimidated by the fact that I had not actually come with, you know, a nuclear physics background. So it was some of the best colleagues I've had and continue to talk with and keep in touch with. You know, I think, you know, from that, I did a bit of a change or a pivot, if you will. And then I came into today's topic from another angle, which is focusing specifically on diversity and inclusion in the national security workforce. It was a topic that under the previous administration, there were leaders at the National Security Council who felt strongly about the fact that they weren't seeing diverse leaders at the top of the organizations that are responsible for national security, for nuclear issues, for global health issues. And so we made a concerted effort and, you know, took on a project for about a year and a half before the end of the administration to really look at, you know, what is the makeup of the national security community? You know, what are the challenges and obstacles that are preventing this workforce in particular from becoming more diverse? Because we know that there are unique challenges, like a security clearance, like some of the topics that tend to, you know, have these old boys club type networks that can be hard to break into, and they don't have lateral hiring. And so really what you saw at the end of the day was the leadership that you have, you know, right now are the people who happen to have made it through a pipeline that started about 30 years ago. So we took a lot of the learnings. We did an interagency task force for about, you know, for that year and a half, and came up with what we issued in October of 2016, which was a presidential memorandum to promote diversity and inclusion in the national security workforce. It's a long title. I still trip up about it sometimes. But in essence, you know, just to kind of share the framework and for further discussion if we want later, you know, focused on kind of three things that I think are continue, you know, even when I see what's happening today, and I'm, you know, now in the private sector, and I am continuing to be engaged in diversity, equity, and inclusion discussions now. There are three kind of core elements from that memorandum that I learned that I think are still kind of needed as the foundation for an effective DEI plan and strategy. And I'll just share briefly, you know, the first is on transparency, you know, having organizations that are willing to be transparent about their, you know, their workforce, about their numbers, how they do their hiring, you know, how they promote people. I think if they're not honest with themselves, it's obviously going to be impossible for them to make the changes that they want to see. And honest with themselves and honest with, you know, potential employees, with consumers, with the general public. Secondly, I'd say, you know, access to opportunity came up a lot. You know, it's very, we continue to see that, you know, how you are chosen for, you know, certain positions in government, you know, whether it's certain leadership programs or whether it's kind of those senior advisor programs that are not always, you know, formally advertised, you know, how those jobs are how candidates are chosen for those jobs is really important. And it's important to make sure that you are pulling in a diverse pool of talent from the very get-go. Otherwise, you're not going to end up with, you know, again, a diverse workforce. And then lastly, I think can't be underscored enough is leadership engagement and more importantly, accountability. You know, we learned a lot and I will say, you know, I was so pleasantly surprised sometimes by who I didn't expect to be diversity, equity, and inclusion champions. And then they ended up being really committed to making sure that they, you know, achieved their goals and to do right by their workforce. It was a business case, but really, you know, I think they understood it at a very moral and personal level. And I thought that that was what really gave any DEI strategy the impetus it really needed to be, you know, to filter down throughout the workforce and to gain buy-in from everyone, from managers who are, you know, hiring their first assistant to, you know, assistant secretaries to deputy secretaries and all the way to the top. So those were, that's what I learned on that, working on that project. And I, you know, have continued to engage with different folks in the national security community to continue to work with them and advise them as necessary to make sure that we can keep some of the good work going, you know, regardless of who's in office, but to make sure that we can do so in and out of government.
Jane, thank you very much. Now let's turn to Loyce. Loyce, are you still with us?
I am absolutely still with you. I think that the host might have control over my video for some reason, but I can go ahead and get started until that turns on. Thanks. I want to thank the organizers for having me today and for having this discussion. I think it's critically important. As others have mentioned, I think there's those of us who've been anxious about the diversity or lack thereof in our sector overall for a number of years. And just want to applaud people who are really trying to speak up and out about this issue and not leave it to, you know, a smaller grouping of folks to lead the charge. But I think, as Bonnie and others have said, you know, it's really going to take all of us to not just solve these problems in our sector, in our respective areas in which we work, but also this very critical shortcoming of a lack of diversity in the space. So a little bit about me and the Global Health Council for people who don't know, because we're not solely in the national security sector. We obviously care very much about these issues. We are a coalition of organizations that advocate for a number of issues, we like to say from AIDS to Zika. And so given even just those parameters or those bookends that I'm calling out, I think hopefully it's clear to people that it's very much a national security agenda for us as well. Global health very much encompasses health security and anything we do or a lot of what we do is critically important to that area of work, in particular, given the current situation, right? We are in a pandemic, we are currently living through a global health emergency. And so GHC, Global Health Council, has been very busy along with our partners and other stakeholders really trying to beat this back. And given that, as people have said, we really need to be sure everyone is brought to the table. I identify as a woman, I'm also Black American by background. And so I guess when I, you know, in offering some remarks on why I think this is important, I'll take that apart in both those ways. So first of all, when it comes to gender and highlighting women in particular, I can appreciate how Jane really talked about the importance of leadership in the space, as did Bonnie. And we know with regard to this pandemic, for example, women are really the ones on the front line providing healthcare in this country worldwide, and they are seeing the situation when it comes to something like COVID-19 up close, and yet they're not often those at the decision-making table. And that's a real issue, right? Because they just, you know, this is a really important time for everyone to truly understand what's happening on the ground. And we need to be talking to those people, you know, who are seeing cases by the hundreds, by the thousands, really feedback to us what's critically important in terms of our collective response. But beyond the role that women are really playing in COVID directly in providing healthcare services per se, they also are being greatly affected by the current pandemic. And so we, I think, have seen some data around how men might be faring worse than women when it comes to their diagnosis or their outcomes. But I think often that data fails to recognize the shadow pandemic that's happening, and that groups like UN and others have reported. So women earn less on average than men worldwide. Often women are part of an informal sector that gets shut down even more quickly with stay-at-home orders and the like. And so they are at greater risk for that economic insecurity or financial insecurity that puts them at a disadvantage. Not to mention women largely who are affected by domestic violence, unfortunately being locked at home with their abusers or just having no way out of very difficult situations. And so I think a lot of us who are also paying attention to that space are worried about the reporting going down and other resources not being available or not being accessible to women in danger. And so for both of those reasons, we need to make sure that these women, again, are at the table when it comes to not just a COVID response, but any other global health emergency that could put them at greater risk in this way. Now to just pivot to the race issue, right? And the fact that we also lack people who look like me in this space, particularly at the leadership level. We've done a sweep of our own membership and really identified for them how much work we have to do amongst global health organizations to ensure that I am not such an anomaly. And that's important too, especially when we think about a global health emergency, because again, we hear all of the reporting in this country, we see the reality that Black and brown people are more affected than other groupings or populations. And the same is true around the world. But I think beyond those outcomes and the risk of those groups, I really think a lot about unintended consequences by not having certain groups of people at the table. I've been really disheartened to hear language used around COVID-19 being associated with China or people of Asian descent. And I think when we hear those stories of how people are being discriminated against because of that association, because of that misinformation, it really does all of us a disservice. I think we saw something similar with Ebola in Africa. And I think if we are to bring more people of color to the table, who are helping highlight how some of the messages or language that we use can perpetuate those issues and that disconnect, I guess, or again, that misinformation or misperception, I think we will help to close that gap and ensure that people aren't misinformed by all of the issues we're trying to face, and we're truly, you know, not leaving anyone behind in that regard, and not, again, really putting anyone at risk in another social space by branding them in a certain way. So I'll stop there. I appreciate this discussion. I'm grateful to be here. I know we'll have a little bit more back and forth around kind of the change we wish to see. But with that, I'll turn it back to you, Deb.
Great. Thank you very much, Loyce. Shawn, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Deb. And thank you to NTI for having me today on behalf of National Security. Quickly about me, I was a career Navy officer at active duty. I was a Navy officer, flew jet aircraft carriers. After I retired, I didn't time the defense complex, the real thing, then I found myself in this country for the Obama administration. The Department of Defense, Executive Secretary of the Department of Transportation, and I'm serving as a commissioner on the National Commission on Military National Service. we just returned to Congress a month ago, and how more people can work in different ways in much international public service. And that was the 3-year journey that has been informed a lot of fresh air, data, opportunity access. And a year ago, with some fellow Obama administration colleagues in defense, we founded National Security, a nonprofit.
Shawn, we're having a little difficulty hearing you. So what I recommend, because of your internet, if you would be willing just to turn your video portion off, that oftentimes can improve it. Wonderful. Thank you very much.
How do you hear me now?
Yes, it's much better. Thank you.
Terrific. Thank you. So we founded out National Security a year ago with 3 big goals over time to raise the profile of serving LGBTQ people in national security that we defined, not just in government, but all the institutions that surround it. Also to connect those people who serve national security, as well as the groups, employee and pride groups, and the professional affinity groups that are out there in order to raise up people who connect as models for young LGBT Americans to provide sponsorship, mentorship, as well as they have high points of people who want to serve in national security. We're very much inspired by what WCAPS has done in that role. They set a real standard in that way. Why do I think what we're talking about here today is important? We're talking about policy and health security. Many years ago, I was a mission commander for a tactical jet aircraft that had a mission of nuclear weapon delivery. When I was my squadron's nuclear weapons officer, I had the responsibility, and actually I consider it a privilege, while on a combat deployment, I had to implement the President George H.W. Bush Presidential Nuclear Initiative and remove my squadron's delivery capability, personally taking boxes out of airplanes and personally destroying all the records so that we were in compliance and we couldn't drop or be asked to employ weapons anymore. It will always be one of the most consequential days of my life. And yet here we are in 2020, and I find my country has actively abandoned control in the nuclear industry that I connected in my life. Speaking to you, audio only now, but from my spare bedroom, and we're not in person because we're in the midst of a pandemic that has been badly handled. Nuclear policy and health security are issues that affect everyone on the planet. There's no dispute to that. And because of that, diverse voices in the organizations that address those issues could not be more important. What do I hope changes? What I think is the type of change? Diversity, and my colleagues here on the panel have talked about this in part already. Diversity has to be a mission priority of an organization. I think I've come to understand that it's not an HR issue, it's not a staffing issue, it's not an internal process issue with regard to fairness of promotion. It has to be as equal to your mission as anything else that goes on, and on that par with the personal investment of leadership has been mentioned there. So I'd just like to say thank you for having me today, and I really look forward to the conversation to come.
Good, thank you very much, Shawn, and I'm sorry about the disruption with your audio and video. Hopefully you'll be able to pick it back up during the panel. Laura, I'm going to turn the final speech to you before we go into the panel. Laura, you're still on mute. There
Got
you
it.
Go.
Good afternoon. It's a thrill to be on a panel with so many great voices and leaders on this issue. And I'm really proud to be representing NTI as well as Gender Champions on this panel. I've been in the national security field for over 30 years in academia, in 5 different government agencies, and at the Nuclear Threat Initiative. And I've been involved in formal and informal efforts to support and promote women for most of that time. Except for NTI, where women have outnumbered men in management since its founding 19 years ago, I've observed and experienced women being outnumbered, spoken over, disrespected, not listened to, not promoted, harassed, and called out in ways large and small. I've also been fortunate to have seen and experienced how women have succeeded and led in the nuclear policy field. But still, study after study highlights the underrepresentation of women in the national security field, especially at senior levels. And the persistence of this gender gap in the face of a growing pipeline of talented women joining the field means that this problem is institutional and that it demands structural change. The decades of work by women and a few male allies have not been enough to break through to gender equity. And so institutional change requires, in addition to that, top-down leadership and direction. And that's why the gender champions model was so appealing to me. Gender champions in nuclear policy started with the leaders of non-government organizations and philanthropies working on nuclear issues and has spread to include the heads of professional societies, national nuclear laboratories, and even nuclear companies. These leaders have pledged to avoid, wherever possible, appearing on single gender panels, as well as made three specific measurable pledges tailored to their own organization's needs to improve gender equity in their own organization. We just published the first impact report reflecting on the first year of gender champions in nuclear policy. And that showed that the majority of the pledges that were made have been met, but also that there's room for more ambition in the pledges as they are renewed and updated. And in that sense, we welcome the updated pledges that Secretary Moniz just announced earlier on this panel. But we also have to recognize that while we're making progress in this non-government space, the dominant, the federal government is the dominant primary national security employer. And there's so much more that needs to be done in the government space to enhance gender equity. And some of these activities have been piloted by these organizations that have been doing it in the private sector. And they're on the Gender Champions websites, gcnuclearpolicy.org. And they can be easily uptaken by government leaders and managers. But many point to the long hours and the extensive travel that's common to national security jobs as reasons that women may exit the field. But our collective COVID experience is showing us that telework is more viable for many jobs than we may have expected. And innovation in secure communications could allow telework even for positions that rely on access to classified information. So there's a lot the government can do to address these structural issues as well. Representation is also important. We're hearing a lot these days, you can't be what you can't see. And so that really puts the burden on panel organizers, talk show producers and bookers and editors, and all need to do better to locate and elevate women experts and authors to make sure that their products reflect the diversity of experience and insight that really improve the impact. And I think that's the primary point, that there's lots of good reasons to support diversity relating to equity and justice, but there's the plain old version of it just makes your product better. And that is visible in business and in the private sector. So we're Gender Champions is thrilled to be making its contribution to improving diversity, equity, and inclusion in this space.
Thank you very much, Laura, and thanks to all of our panelists for your insights, your candor, and for speaking so honestly and openly about your own experiences. We're about to pivot to our panel with a set of questions, but before we do that, thank you to our audience who has patiently listened, and we want to engage you again with a second poll. So I'm sorry, we're actually now releasing the results of the first poll before getting into the second poll. And as I mentioned, we will have all of this information available to you after the webinar, and we'll be emailing it out. So I know this is moving very quickly in terms of the results. So here is the second poll in terms of what resources you and your organization most need in order to be able to make progress on these issues. So with that, while we are, while you all are answering this question, I'd like to turn back to our panelists to ask a few questions just to get us kicked off. My first set of questions is going to be for Bonnie and Shawn. When we first originally conceived of this panel, many of us were not far along in having challenging conversations about race, diversity, and the importance of inclusion. Many are beginning to do so now. So I would love to hear your perspective on whether you would agree with that statement and how you think the conversation is shifting and what has struck you during this time, to both Bonnie and Shawn.
I guess I'll start. I guess I'll start by saying that the issues of race and DEI were kind of paramount in my organization from the very beginning. So for me, that part hasn't changed in terms of the focus of the issue to the organization itself. But I will say what's been really wonderful is the increased engagement of other individuals and organizations on this issue. There's certainly a feeling, and you get this question all the time, is this a moment? Is this a, you know, is this a movement? I'd like to say that it's certainly more of a movement than I've seen in my life on these issues of race and discrimination and DEI. There's certainly many more people involved, many more races involved. There's much more, there's a huge feeling that something needs to change, and people are taking it up. And you're seeing a willingness to march to try to make that change. And so that certainly is different. Hearing about how organizations want to take on the issues, want to focus on it, want to do things concrete is welcome. It's great to hear. That's different. And of course, as I said earlier, for me right now, my focus is sustaining that. I mean, that's really what I'm thinking about mostly because, you know, I've seen these in my lifetime and I've seen the abuse. But for me, it's about what do we do tomorrow? What are we doing 6 months? And what are we doing 1 year from now? That to me is the test. So this is great. I love seeing it, but we need to see how it changes. So in essence, yes, it's a change. It's a movement. I call it a movement. I want to keep the movement going. So thanks.
Yeah, you're right. It's a question of sustainability and looking to the future on that. Shawn, what else would you like to add?
Thank you. I hope you can hear me well on the trusty old phone line.
Yes. Thank you very much. Okay. We can.
Great. Thank you. Follow on what Bonnie just had to say, I've been impressed by what many folks refer to as the intersectionality of what we've seen. It very much started out as something with regard to Black Americans, but then the amount of common cause that was found with other minority and disadvantaged groups standing side by side, shoulder to shoulder, but also notice has been made and statements have been made about how many people who are traditionally would be thought of as being the privileged people who might be silently part of the problem are out there with so many people. I find it very interesting as to how quickly the race for many organizations, businesses, and such to make statements that they could actually be held account to over time as promises to have conversations, be open, try and get better and to change much more so than in the past. Very quickly, it became pretty obvious it was a moment and you had to get on it or you were gonna miss it and be held to account immediately. But as Bonnie said, that's great today, but what about 6 months, 12 months, and years from now? Do we seize it? But there have been some incredible conversations I've been privy to be a part of, that very frank conversations. But I agree wholeheartedly with what Bonnie said. I hear all this great stuff, but I say to that, so what, now what, and what next? Because we have significant work to do across our society and across our organizations and our disciplines to actually implement the things that so many of us agree upon.
Thank you, Shawn. I'm about to turn to Laura and Loyce with another question, but before I do that, I want to encourage all of the audience to give us the questions that you would like to have answered, and to please do so in the Q&A box at the bottom of your Zoom. So in the meantime, both Laura and Loyce, I wanted to get your sense of priority, recognizing that different organizations are at different places in working on DEI-related issues. And if you had to point to one or two things that you think are particularly important right off the bat for organizations to be doing, what would that be?
Well, I think that question. Thanks, Laura, I appreciate that. I guess for me, you know, we were talking at a higher level just now about institutional changes. And I agree, those are heartening to see. Although we have talked internally, and I have been talking about the importance of individual changes alongside those, I think oftentimes when we have seen this movie before, or read certain chapters of this book, you know, there have been a lot of pledges and commitments and other things that have been highlighted as powerful and critically important. And yet there's still quite a bit of hand wringing even in 2020 about what more can be done and whether it will stick. And so it makes me really think about the personal action that we can each take. And I'm grateful to others for reminding me of this. I think, for example, Laura just talked about bookings and events, and they can work, you know, that's one side of the equation. In other words, we can get those producers and, you know, organizers to do differently, if not better. But we can also have the people receiving those invites be mindful of who's missing. So if you are a CEO and you've been in this role for a decade and you always speak at that same event every year, maybe one year when you get that invitation, you say, you know what, maybe it doesn't need to be me. Maybe it could be someone else who, again, doesn't look exactly like me or who offers another voice. Even if you still go, can you negotiate a 2-for-1? Right, where it's like, okay, you get me if I can bring this other person along, this young person, this Black person, you know, this other person who has a different identity that's not often on stage. And I think we can do that with media too. You get that call from that journalist or from that news organization, and you can defer them to someone else. I mean, I will share an anecdote that even during a pandemic, I'm running a global health organization. I have received calls and emails from news corporations that want to speak to the previous white male executive director of my organization. And I would like to think that that person will send that back to me, knowing that, you know, that's part of the issue and part of the problem. I'd like to think that I can represent us well enough, if not as well as he does, in that same forum. But it requires, again, everyone individually realizing what's happening or what isn't, and doing his or her part in that scenario.
Oops, sorry, Laura.
Yeah, so I think that individual change that Loyce just talked about is so critical. But organizations can help make that easier. They can create deep policies that make someone pause and think whether they're on the organizing end or the receiving end of those kinds of activities. And I think those, you know, kind of baking those into our standard operating procedures is going to be critical to making sure that 6 months and a year from now, we still have those abilities. The other thing comes, I really want to re-highlight this representation issue, the visibility of the diversity and the importance that you have to be ready to showcase people in your organization who might not always get the spotlight or to be sure that you're bringing people into your organization that you're proud to put out there. And so I'm hopeful that both an inward gaze and an outward gaze can be managed at the same time, because they're both critical and they reinforce each other.
Good, thank you very much. Jane, I have a question for you. Building on your earlier presentation of the work you did as part of a study looking at these issues within government, I was curious about, in the course of your interviews and your discussions, what do you think people who haven't experienced structural inequity need to hear and understand, and whether those were things that came up in your interviews?
So, you know, I think one thing I would say to that question actually is everyone has experienced structural inequity. It's just, it depends on which side you've been on it, and whether you've been a recipient or a part of the system. You know, I heard someone recently describe it as, I think it was on Oprah. I'm going to give full credit to it was someone on Oprah. I forget who it was, but that it was I think it was Charles Blow, that it was a seesaw, right? That you are up because I am down, or I am down because you are up. And so we are all connected in this system of inequity. And I think that's kind of the first step of, you know, I think of acknowledging that there's no such thing as a level playing field, and there never has been. And once people start to understand that the system is built, you know, what we take for granted, what we all take for granted, because it's just, you know, part of the infrastructure of the way we were educated and went through school and then got into jobs, is that it always privileged some people over others. And I think that's kind of the first important step for folks to try and, you know, start to identify on your own, you know, where are the times when I have been privileged, and then there may be times also when you have not been privileged. You know, and I say that as someone who's, you know, obviously not white and not Black, and there's a whole other perspective and education for, I think, people who are people of color but who are not Black, who also need to understand their role in that system, that it's not binary. I mean, I use the seesaw analogy, but we do realize at the end of the day that, you know, it's much more multi-layered than that. And then I would just add two more things really quickly. One is, you know, I think the things that we're all being asked to do now, it's very, you have to be deliberate about it. You know, we are being asked to unlearn a lot of things right now in a very kind of accelerated timeline, and that's a good thing, I think. I mean, I love that, you know, in some ways, like COVID has accelerated changes that we probably would have taken years to accomplish. You know, this is kind of a similar moment in the racial justice space. And so I think, you know, if you're mindful and deliberate about how these changes are happening and how you can help advance them from your own individual identity, then, you know, I think that's important for people to understand that it's not going to be resolved overnight. And then lastly, I've just, you know, there was someone else, I remember we rolled out the presidential memorandum, I remember, at CSIS, I was there that day, and there was a panel later that day, and someone from the intelligence community, when they, you know, I think the question was something about, you know, what's the business case for diversity, which is always, I get the purpose of the question, but it puts a burden on, you know, especially people of color, and to say, well, here's why I should matter. Here's why, you know, I need to argue my way into this room or to the table. And she very smartly said, you know, well, tell me, what's the business case for conformity? You know, you turn it around and you think, what's the argument to keep things going the way they are, you know, when we all know that the studies are out there about groupthink, but really, because we are the country that we are and we have the diverse population that we have an increasingly diverse, you know, pool of students who are graduating with degrees across the field. And, you know, obviously many more women than we had before, but, you know, just, and also racially and ethnically, it's becoming more diverse. We are doing ourselves a disservice if we continue to hire and promote people the same way we've always been doing without acknowledging that reality.
Good, thank you, Jane. Before we go to our lightning round, I wanna go back to Loyce, who has an additional comment that she wants to raise with respect to this question of value that a number of you on the panel have touched on. I would also encourage folks to look again at the chat throughout, because there's been some interesting remarks also made by our panelists in the chat reflecting on what they're hearing from their other co-panelists. So with that, Loyce, let me turn it back to you.
Thanks, Deb. I appreciate this bit of back and forth in this virtual panel. But no, Jane, I just really wanted to second where you were landing. You know, this idea of what gets valued. I'm also pulling in, I think, what I heard Laura say, which is bring on people who you're you know, you're proud to put out there, who could speak for you. And I think, you know, how are we assessing this? You know, like, how are we measuring what it, what good is, you know, or like what smart is? And this is something beyond national security, obviously, but in a discipline that is so arguably intellectual, I think it can easily fall into this trap that we see in ivory towers and in other settings where we're kind of, you know, we're already pegging people as, you know, as whether or not they can speak a certain way or convey a certain thing. And again, that might not be the only thing that needs to be conveyed in this moment. They might use language or even have ideas that will further our agenda and that will be just as intelligent and brilliant and just as valuable. And it's, you know, it's a blind spot for those of us who have been at this for far too long. I think we even see this intergenerationally, right? So I just really wanted to highlight that and challenge all of us to rethink our definition of value and really, and as it relates to the status quo and kind of what we've been accepting as, you know, right, wrong, good, bad, what have you. Thanks, Deb.
Good, thanks, Loyce. So I'm going to turn now to a real quick lightning round before we open it up to the audience's question. And this will be for each of our panelists, real quick, you know, 20, 30 seconds. What book or resource has taught you the most about these issues? And as you answer, we can also capture that in the chat. So I know for folks that are going to want to go look up these resources themselves that they can have advantage of having that. So I'm going to start with you, Laura.
So the book I keep returning to and the gender champion journey is called What Works by Iris Bolin. And it is a wealth of really data-driven social science tested ways to get bias out of institutional behavior, whether it's hiring, promotion, pay, you know, judgments of value, as Loyce was just talking about. And it's super practical. It's a hard slog. It's not a beach read, but I learned so much and it's just really practical.
Bonnie.
Thank you. And I actually have to cheat on this question because I get it often. And actually, I am finding that I am just doing a lot of reading these days about so many issues in terms of just the issues that we're going through. I mean, I love reading James Baldwin, just overall the stuff that he does, and just some older writers who put a lot of issues of race into perspective, into historical perspective, and understanding where so much of what we're going through comes from. So, you know, I'm going to cheat and you can't, I guess you won't be able to put anything in chat for me except to say that I learn from our forefathers and our foremothers on these issues. And I am a constant student in understanding why our culture is what it is, why we think what we think, why we treat people the way we do. And it's just an ongoing journey that just continues. So thanks.
Good, thank you. I really appreciate your comment about putting it back into perspective of the long perspective and the long horizon on this, particularly in this moment where there's an urgency around doing actions quickly, which are important, but this is for, as you said earlier, sustaining it over the long term. Shawn, turn to you.
Thank you. When you posed the question, what resource, the resource I've relied upon in the last month or so since things became so focused, I don't mean to be trite, it's really been my ears. And when I use my military aphorisms, I've switched to receive mode. I've got little to say, and I need to be absorbing everything that's out there from, as Bonnie just mentioned, James Baldwin, but also hearing from the people via Twitter and all these other things, from people who have lived it and are living it in the moment and what it means. And I'm applying that listening to stuff that I've been trying to develop for several years now. And it just so happens that some of the writers are generals, but I think that just makes their points more salable to the general public with General Martin Dempsey's book on radical inclusion you've got to get down below yourself and reach out and pull everybody into what's being done. Both he and General Stan McChrystal have written and talked about servant leadership. You're not there to lead and be Alexander the Great. You're there to help people, make the way for them, raise them up so they can do what needs to be done. And also, it's the power of empathy. And all of those things are empowered by listening. So I've just been trying to be an active listener and show that I'm engaged, but at the same time, zipping it and going into MCON. So thanks.
Good. Thank you, Shawn. Jane?
Two that came to mind. One is anything by Mahzarin Banaji, who's one of the people who came up with the unconscious bias field, I guess. You know, I remember doing some early trainings that I got to sit in on when I was still at the National Security Council, but I had some private companies that invited me to kind of sit in on the trainings that they did. And one of them had invited her, you know, and took people through the tests that she had developed and other things. But I just want to give due credit to her for kind of helping pioneer that field decades ago. And then more recently, I last year I read The Warmth of Other Suns, and I know that's been on a lot of these lists of books and things like that. I like that one, and just because it helped, you know, I think start to fill a gap of, you know, the history that we learn in school of, like, we had the Civil War and then Reconstruction and then we had Civil Rights Act, and then, like, in between, you know, you just don't know a ton. You know, you know that Jim Crow exists, but what was that actually like, and how systemically you know, it filtered through every aspect of people's lives and essentially kept them from being able to exercise any of the freedoms that they, you know, officially were supposed to have gotten after the end of the Civil War. So that's one that I recommend.
Thank you, Jane. Loyce?
So I was gonna answer in the way Bonnie did, leaning on my elders, certainly, and there are a ton of wise sages, past and present, all of whom are listed online that you all can look up. But somebody else that I just grabbed a book that I also lean on a lot is called Emergent Strategy by Adrienne Marie Brown. And I think it's important because it reminds us how to kind of break the box in terms of how we evolve and how that can be iterative and not so linear, which is just, you know, we can have a whole nother conversation of why things are structured that way and why that's the rule. And then specifically to this discussion, I do want to call out again what's already in the chat, the Operation 50-50 toolkit put out by Women in Global Health. As well as Decolonizing Development, led up by PopWorks Africa and Stephanie Kimu, who's really brilliant in this space and who's really helping at least people in the development and health sectors really unpack this idea of racism and structural discrimination. Thanks.
Great. Well, thank you. You've given us a series of richness with all of your recommendations, and we'll be sure to collect them and send them out so that as we gather them in the chat, either now or subsequently. We're going to do one final poll before we open to the audience questions. And thank you to our audience. We have quite a few. This is the result of the second poll, and then we're going to be issuing a third poll as well. And here's the third poll. And this relates to what you would like to see in future webinars on topics. And you can also feel free to send us email if you think of topics or issues after today. So while you're answering that, I'd like to turn back to our panelists. And there is a question that's come in from Gonzalo Suarez, who writes, from a USG perspective, what's the best way for a bureau, or how can we at the bureau level partner with outside organizations to improve diversity in the recruitment pool? So with that, I would just ask if any of our panelists want to address that, but I may turn first to Jane, given the work that you did in terms of any ideas that you may have on that.
Sure. It's great. I mean, I think it's first, it's a great attitude to start from, not just, you know, that the change has to come from the top, but that everyone has some agency in how they are able to make some change. You know, not knowing obviously what agency this is part of, or you know, or which field it may be in, maybe it's related to nuclear issues or global health issues. You know, I'd say it's definitely, you know, thinking along the entire pipeline. So obviously you're starting from schools, universities, obviously is a place to start, and learning more about, you know, which organization, and I know, you know, there's a lot of agencies, you know, already recruit heavily from HBCUs, and you know, so it's not just focusing on those, but every university, and sometimes it can be a regionally focused initiative. You know, we don't have a lot of geographic diversity either anymore, and I think that's important because that is in some ways correlated with race and ethnicity. You know, thinking about academic institutions you can partner with about how they promote certain fields, you know, and I think probably at the agency level, you can have more initiative and power to do things like, you know, establishing centers of excellence and things like that, which I know we've done, that various agencies have done with certain academic institutions. You know, it's looking at all the organizations, I think, that are in the respective field that that your bureau may be involved in, and you know, have a group conversation. And what does that field look like? You know, do these organizations understand their own role in, you know, whether they're part of the recruitment kind of part of the pipeline, or the retention part of the pipeline, or the talent development part of the pipeline. So I think just having those conversations, you know, start one-on-one if there's one that you think can be particularly receptive or open. You know, and whether you establish a formal partnership or anything like that, but just, you know, I think having a mutual recognition of what you are trying to achieve, and then having that kind of awareness, build that out through various programs, through, you know, who they invite on panels and things like that. I mean, it's going to take time, but I think that's a place to start.
Great. Shawn, do you want to add on this one?
Thank you, Deb. And just briefly, Jane just did a fantastic job and stole what little thunder I thought I was going to bring. But it really is, for agencies, bureaus, organizations, it's getting beyond just the hiring interface with people. It's getting, the word was used, awareness, getting out there. The commission that I served on, we looked at how to get people to see themselves serving in different places in the federal government, state governments, and the like. And we looked at it from a framework of awareness leads to aspiration, which leads to an attempt to have people access the opportunities to do all these different things. Right now, many government organizations only interface with the public or potential employees or workforce members at the point of the hiring interface directly. And we don't go further, you know, to the left of the equation, so to speak, and seed awareness and aspiration with these folks when they're as undergrads or in grad programs and the like, where you're just doing outreach and understanding, go, this is what the possibilities are. And you don't have to be just this one discipline. You can bring all these different kinds of things to play and build. And many of the things that we're talking about are a generational voyage. While we still have to do near-term, immediate-term, high-priority action, we still have to turn the ship and go on that long voyage, and that's some of the stuff that can be done.
We have another question that's come in from Saruthi Katakam from Johns Hopkins University, and the question that is posed is, how do we ensure that things that are put forward in the spirit of DEI are not just tokenism, but really do add to value, picking back up the value word, over time to improve and make changes in the individual as well as the organization? Loyce?
I thought you were gonna ask his other question, or Sruti's other question, but I'll try to take this one. I think it's by filling the pipeline with more of us. So, you know, I feel as long as there's just a handful of me or Bonnie, let's say, then it will feel more tokenistic. And I think we see that in the global health or development sectors when we're just kind of propping up one person from the global south to speak at an event or to media. But if we can fill our events in the way that you all have done with different types of people, then it just, you know, I think it lends itself to not being so special or unique or such an event, you know?
Yeah, I'd also like to add to that. I think that these things that you can tell through time. I think that, you know, whether there is real sincere commitment to something will be evident. And there has to be a change, not just a symbolic change in terms of, you know, things in the facade. You have to be able to look deeper within an organization and see change in all parts of an organization. You have to see change in the type of products that might be being produced, the research. You have to see it throughout whatever entity you're talking about, because there's different type of entities that play a role in policy, either nuclear or health. So whether you're talking about NGOs or think tanks or, academic institutions, you have to see it reflected throughout. And that's not just in the makeup and who's there, whose faces are there, but it's also a feeling within the organization. And the thing is, if you are the quote unquote the other, if you're the one that's different, you're able to tell very quickly if something is real and something is not. And so if you want to know if there's real change and you want to know if something is a token and is it or not, ask a person of color or a woman. But ask the person who is the other, whatever the other might be, how do they feel? Do you feel included? Do you feel like it's real? Do you feel like you're getting with the whole microaggression? You know, are people saying things to you at the cooler that maybe it's not being felt everywhere else, but you feel it and you see it? And so sometimes the best people to ask are the people who are not of the mainstream, but you have to have enough people there to have the question, to ask the question with. So, you know, it's you could tell if it's tokenism, you can tell if it's not real, because you can see a change in the organization or whatever institution you're talking about. And so, and it takes time, but you have to be able to be willing to be measured, you have to be willing to be held accountable, and sometimes entities don't want that. And when you have that, then you have to ask the question, how much do you really want to change? So.
Laura, do you want to comment?
Yeah, I think there's been a lot of work done on this. And so, each organization needs to be kind of testing itself with its own community, but, you know, it's not mysterious, some of this stuff. And that's why I really like the book by Iris Bonet, but there's other ones out there as well that, you know, an expertise that can be, you know, paid for and rewarded. This isn't free labor that ought to be, you know, just given. For, you know, there's resources that organizations have, and on for gender equity, the Gender Champions website has a lot of resources, including consultants who can come work with institutions to do change that is meaningful. But there's experience that, you know, there's data out there on what does actually work to take that bias out of structures.
We've gotten quite a few questions in the Q&A related to the pipeline and discussions around the pipeline. And several of you on this panel have commented on this. And specifically what folks in the audience are asking about is understanding that a pipeline and bringing new and different people and voices in takes time. How or what are some steps that can be taken to address some of the dearth of diversity at mid and senior levels? And I'll add on to that also ways to retain talent so that they don't leave the field. Jane?
I can take part of that question, I think. It is a big issue, I would say, in certain parts of the broader national security foreign policy workforce, as I think many of you know, with organizations like the military and the foreign service, which don't allow for, you know, mid-level hiring or above. And so you really are, like I said, developing a pipeline from scratch. And the first day you go into one of these institutions, that is the most diverse your class will ever be. And in 25 years, that's the, you know, your leadership will be less diverse than my guess, unless you have perfect retention, you know, than how you started. So, you know, for large parts of, I think, of that workforce, this is a particularly important question. You know, I've talked to a lot of people who have left various government agencies. You know, it's not all that different sometimes. The things that they're looking for are, you know, flexibility. You know, we are still living in a world in which the assumption is that you're coming from, you know, a nuclear family. You're probably a white man and you have a lot of support at home, you know, to take care of your personal life while you come to work and are able to work long hours. Things have slightly improved, but I think actually with COVID, you know, the ways that we have really fundamentally disrupted the way we have to work to continue a lot of these things, I hope that organizations actually take a lot of lessons from that and realize that they can let go of some of these old assumptions, because I think that will really help people from all backgrounds who are trying to continue to work in these fields and who have at times been driven out because they just couldn't end up maintaining that balance. And it's not just about the gender balance of, like, you know, women with kids and, you know, it's everyone who has different obligations in their lives that I think were affected by these very rigid structures that we had in the past.
Anyone else want to add to that?
I'll take a stab, Shawn? If I could.
Yes, please.
In part of that, I think it was mentioned as to, you know, and it's about retaining people. I think Jane might have mentioned retention in there, or Deb, you might have mentioned retention. That's something that I haven't studied for the last couple of years with my commission. And it's really about, what comes to mind for me is that, I guess it was a song, you know, if you love something, set it free. If you value people who have performed and are talented in your organization and they feel a need to take a direction, much as that's in concert with what we've seen about how people's families and situations have been risen to the consciousness of everyone in the current pandemic issue. You just saw people as employees in the office, and all of a sudden, you know that they've got kids and dogs and family members who are at increased risk because of this that you didn't ever know before. Likewise, if folks want to go in a different direction, take a sabbatical, things like that, try put their skills in another place, you have to have some confidence and trust in your organization that you can set them free and that they may very well want to come back to you. The government very much needs to do that. And what you have to do is set your organization up to be able to receive them when they come back. Because if you treated them well enough, there's a chance some of them will indeed want to come back for all the right reasons, whether it's maybe the experience wasn't so great or as I expect on the outside, or they missed it so much they want to come back. And can you facilitate that? And do they know that you can? So a lot of that's, mobility is on an organization. But in terms of bringing people in mid-career, I thought Jane made a great point as to some organizations, you just can't do it, or it would be very difficult. But I think organizations, it's incumbent upon leadership to really break it down and go, well, what does it take to succeed in our organization? Did you have to enter the door 15 years ago? Or what are the skills it takes to be that successful mid-level person? The component skills, not the title, not the job that you had, but what are the no kidding school skills, problem solving, team leading, an ability to understand science. And then what are the technical competencies that really matter? And are those available in other fields, in other ways? And re-piece that together so that you're not seeing job titles and explicit experience, but actually competencies that are available more widely in people. You've got to get out of your own head and your own straitjackets.
Good, thank you. I'm mindful that we're coming up on time, but I want to make sure we get two last questions in. We have a question from Gloria Atameklo, who writes that she is a 20-something African woman trying to enter the nuclear field and international security policy field, and any advice that you would have for her? Oh, come on. We have a lot of people on this panel who could comment.
I'll start. First of all, join my organization, because we have women of color who are many who are young and are getting into the field of weapons of mass destruction, nuclear issues, and so it's an opportunity to see who else is in the field. There's something really, really magical when you see other women who are like yourself or others who are like yourself or whatever group you're in. That in itself increases your interests, your desire to be in a field, that you can see others like yourself, particularly of your own age group, and you share some of the same challenges that you're having. So having that space, having that, what we call a safe space to be there and deal with some of the challenges of getting into the field. I would say that I know that there are young people and people of color who have wanted to get into the field and have been discouraged because they have not been able to find enough opportunities. I would say to have a wide berth of areas that you're looking into and places you're looking into work in. There's several type of institutions that do work on nuclear issues. Obviously there's a government, but there's obviously NGOs that you're seeing today, and think tanks and a lot of other entities that are involved in this field. So, you know, have a wide berth, don't get discouraged. Don't be discouraged by what may seem like a closed field or feel like you have to know all the right people or you have to be a major scientist to be in all this work. There's many people who do it who have many different backgrounds. So I would just say to if this is what you want to do, to stick with it. There's other people who are in this field who are your age or getting into the field, who have an interest in the field. Join the organization, you can meet them, and you know, just stay involved. And like I said, have a wide berth. So thank you.
Anybody else on the panel?
Well, if you're not gonna say it, Deb, I will. Apply for the NTI internship.
Yes, absolutely. I was waiting for you to do that.
Yes, check out the nti.org website. Our fall internship applications are open through the 9th of July, I believe. They're competitive, but it's also a great experience and they are paid. Under the heading of things organizations can do to support young people, pay your interns. And I'm proud that NTI made that choice to do that. So. But there are the other organization I would mention that Bonnie and I both have a history with is Women in International Security. They've got a jobs hotline and a discount rate for junior members. I've just been corrected. It's the 3rd of July is the closing for our internship application. So get your documents in. But Women in International Security is also a resource for both networking and a twice a week jobs hotline. So and I'm sure there's others that are out there as well.
There's also, I would mention that there are some fellowships that are specifically geared to nuclear policy and international and peace and security broadly. And one of which that Bonnie and I are on the board of is the Scoville Fellowship. So I would just encourage you to spend a little bit of time and research some of these fellowships. We have one final question that actually there's been two or three of them that are of the same vein, and this would be broadly for all of our panelists. The first one is from Jay Muntazar, and he asked the question of, and in quotes, law in the absence of enforcement has no power. How does one maintain a balance between one's rights and government's power? And then there is a second question from Rebecca Castleman that raises the question, could you comment on how growing awareness about police brutality and questions around US militarism and the nuclear state, how might the work of Black activists protesting police violence speak to systemic change required in the broad nuclear sector? Anyone want to take that on or pivot broadly?
I'll take a start at it. I think it is a reflection of the growing militarism of our society, that we seem to turn first for the weapon rather than the conversation or the diplomacy. And whether that's happening at the institute, you know, at the community level between, you know, police on one hand versus, you know, social service delivery on the other, or whether it's happening at the national level between, you know, turning to weapons of war versus emphasizing diplomacy. They each have their place. Ideally, they work in tandem, it feels like we have to learn anew with every encounter that there's so much that can be accomplished through the diplomacy side of that spectrum that can prevent you from needing to use the force side. And so I think that we're seeing that in our communities, and we're seeing it globally.
Yeah, I don't think it's that bad at all.
I'm sorry, Loyce, why don't you comment, and then Bonnie, and I'll go to you.
Okay, thanks, Deb. Sorry about that, Bonnie. I think it's, I am not a nuclear security or a policy expert. So with that caveat, I'm thinking more about the Black Lives Matter movement and the calls to defund the police, and how that seems so radical and yet so possible at the same time, into the debate, regardless of where you fall in your opinion of that, or even politically. I think it's all about the opportunity to imagine something that feels or seems so radically different, but is really quite basic, right? We don't want to call people and armed individuals to address certain situations in our society. I'm from the inner city, so I take this very personally, and I've seen it happen. And so I can appreciate how we can apply the same imagination to nuclear policy, whereby it might seem as though we couldn't possibly live in a world that is less militarized. And yet, when we think about what's truly required, or what the needs are and the response that's required, we actually could. It's just a matter of diverting those resources. And it doesn't have to be an either or, depending on where people fall. I think we've seen this with the criminal justice system as well. But there's sort of back to the seesaw analogy that Jane offered, there's just such a, you know, imbalance when it comes to how much we're locking people up and shutting people down. And again, we as Americans often talk about the change we wish to see in the world and the beacon on the hill we like to sort of represent. And so if we are also pointing to other nations and asking for them to demilitarize and be more mindful of their policies and law enforcement and us and otherwise, I think we need to be looking closely at ourselves in that regard too.
Thank you, Bonnie.
Great, thanks. And thanks for that great answer, Loyce. I enjoyed listening to it. I guess for me, it's a similar question of decisions that are made where there's not a real voice of people who are affected, whether it's from the long-term nuclear issues or the closer-to-home issues with police. It's understanding why it's important to be at the table, understanding why it's important to have a voice. And the fact that if you don't have a voice, things can happen to you that you cannot change, you cannot affect because you weren't there. And so whether you're talking about nuclear testing issues and who's tested on, or if you're talking about closer to home with who's being abused and whose rights are being taken away, by the police or others, it all reflects the fact that, you know, if you're not there to have a voice, to impact decision-making, to impact who's going to be affected, there's a similarity there. And so I think that, and I hope that what happens is that by seeing it close to home, that there's an ability to understand the connections far away. Because it's always seemed like the nuclear issue is like, oh, it's way out there, I can't deal with that, you know, it's not me. But if you look at it in a different way and you turn that ball around, you can see the connection, you know, and maybe it's a way to help our youth understand it as a way that is something that's close to home and not so far away.
If I could, Deb, real fast.
Yes, please.
One point that occurred to me, the question was how to maintain a balance between government police power and how did things happen affect militarism in the nuclear state. I'd say, when you've been talking about people being included and their voices being heard, I would say, to use the phrase, vote early and vote often. And by early, I mean shape the people who become the candidates for general election that become the representatives, that people that represent you, and in many cases, the people who are supposed to exercise authority over those police forces, and the members of Congress and the Senate who are supposed to set the budgets and the priorities of the military. I was very taken by, and I don't say this flippantly, I really mean it, the recent Netflix show Space Force. There's a funny little scene. Humor can be the most incisive thing to make a point. When a missile test, they try to test a rocket and it explodes. And how many was that? Three. Oh, $3 million? No, it was three middle schools that just blew up in front of us. That's the way American people and voters can be engaged with. Every one of those things is a choice. Is a choice to put resources. It's a zero-sum game. We can only get in so much debt, we think, we hope. But where money is going to go? Is it going to be three middle schools in a rocket, or is it going to be three middle schools? If you ask me, the greatest investment in national security is K-12 education. And then the economy will cook so much that nobody could ever mess with us. Where do we choose? The people choose who make those things happen. Vote.
Thank you, Shawn. I think that's an apt thing to end on today. I want to thank each panelist very sincerely for myself. I have found that you have absolutely inspired me today to continue my work both individually on advancing DEI as well as organizationally where I can. And I hope what has inspired me has inspired everyone in our audience as well. So thank you very much for taking this time, and also thank you for all you're doing. Really appreciate it very much, and we look forward to future webinars. And thank you to our audience for staying with us for all of this today. So take care and have a good afternoon. Bye-bye.